Hello everyone, welcome to session 23 of Selenium Java training. In today's session, first I am going to continue with test engine. The last two sessions I was explaining about test engine. The last two sessions I covered part one of test engine, and in the yesterday's session, I covered part two of test engine, and in today's session, I am going to continue that and going to cover the part three of test engine. That is, the remaining things that are left out in test engine will be covered today. As I already told you, test engine plays a vital role, that is important role in framework development. So we have to focus more on test engine, guys. Fine, let's continue or finish up the remaining portion of test engine today. The first topic of test engine that I am going to cover is test engine.xml parameterization. So what does it mean, test engine.xml parameterization? So let me explain you. Fine. So if you are writing some code, guys, okay, so if you are writing some code, some automation code you are writing here, let's say, generally you write something like this, right? Driver dot get. In this, you'll hard code the URL. That means you'll provide the URL directly. Here you'll say http://, okay, www.omayo.blogspot.com. okay, you are giving the actual URL here in the code, and somewhere you will be writing some code like driver dot find element by dot some id, okay, email hyphen, okay, address or something, then dot send keys. Here you will provide the email address. You'll hard code the email address generally like this. You'll provide the actual hard coded email address here. So here also email address is hard coded. So this is all about hard coding, guys. Okay, hard coding the URL, hard coding the email address. Similarly, you can hard code the password by dot id some p hyphen, okay, d or something, anything, okay, something dot send keys. And we are just giving some password, okay. Here password is also hard coded. Like this, you are hard coding some URL, email address, okay, and password, etc., etc. But this is not a proper approach, guys. We should not hard code. Okay, there are some problems with hard coding. What if tomorrow this URL changes? What if tomorrow this email address changes? What if tomorrow this password changes? What do you have to do, guys? When this URL changes, what do you have to do for the script to work? We have to again come to the script, modify the URL in the code, right? Yes, we have to again change the URL here. For example, tomorrow this omayo.blogspot.com has become omayo2.blogspot.com. Okay, what you have to do? You have to come to this automation code and change this URL with omayo2.blogspot.com. Tomorrow the email address changes to arun.selenium5@gmail.com. So again you have to come here and change this email address manually in the automation code. Similarly, password. Password changes, you have to come to this automation code manually and change this password so that the script will not work. If you provide wrong data here, the script is going to fail, right? If you give some another URL which is not working, so what will happen? The script will fail, right? Tomorrow if this URL changes, the same script which was working earlier will not work today or tomorrow. Okay, so what we have to do, if you are hard coding, you have to come to this script manually and change everything. That you have to provide proper data, that is workable data at that point of time. But assume that you have some 500 tests, okay? Some 500 automation tests are there. In every 500 automation tests, let's say you have used this URL, you have hard coded the URL. Let's say you have hard coded the URL in every automation test. What will happen, guys? So let's say there are 500 automation tests and you have provided the URL like this, omaya.blogspot.com. In every automation test of 500 automation tests, this driver.get omaya.blogspot.com is provided. And one fine day, the URL got changed to www.omayo2.com, let's say. Okay. So originally, when you automated 500 automation tests, in every automation test, you have provided driver.get is equal to omaya.blogspot.com. But tomorrow, okay, at particular point of time, the URL got changed to www.omaya.2.com. So what you have to do, guys? What you have to do? You have to go to each and every automation test. You have to open each and every automation test and change this URL. Earlier you have given this URL. Okay, this URL you have given. Change this URL to the latest URL like this. So how many times you have to do? You can type in the chat, guys. How many times I have to do this process? There are 500 automation tests. 500 times. Does it take time? Does it take time or not? If one automation test, that is very easy. I can simply open an automation test, single automation test, and change the URL. That's fine. But if there are 500 automation tests and I have to change this URL to a new URL, does it take time or not? Considerable time or not? What do you think, guys? Yes. You are right, guys. Okay. Well, I'm getting all the responses in the chat and you guys are right. So 500 automation tests I have to change, means it will take. And also not only this URL, let's say this email address and password also changed. Like this, in 500 automation tests, everything you did is hard coding only. Okay. So each and every automation test you have to open, you have to change the URL, you have to change the email address. Okay. You have to change the password. And tomorrow the test got increased to 1000 automation tests. Okay. Your burden will increase like anything, guys. For a small change, the URL or email address or password, you have to open each and every automation test and update the or modify the latest changes into the automation test, which will take lot of time. It will take lot of time and it will waste your time. So to overcome this problem, what we have to do, let me explain. So we should have a central kind of thing. Okay. Let's say there are automation tests, 1000 automation tests are automation test one, automation test two, automation test three, like that. Different automation tests are there. All these are automation tests. Let's assume. Okay. I said 500 or 1000, right? Let's assume that these are all the 500 tests. We'll keep a centralized place. Central place. In the central place, we'll put our URL, email, password, etc., etc. Okay, whatever the things that need to be hard, generally we hard code, right? To avoid that hard coding part, we'll create a centralized place where we'll put all the things that should not be hard coded. Okay, all the things that should not be hard coded will be kept in the centralized place. And all these are the test case, this automation test, let's say. Remaining boxes are automation tests. All these automation tests will refer to this particular place. You're getting my point, right? We'll create a such kind of thing where all these automation tests will refer to this particular centralized place. Just visualize this particular thing, nothing more than that. Okay, we are going to implement this process, but how to implement is different. But for now, understand the concept, what is happening. So assume that everything is referring here. Every automation test is referring to this file, something, a centralized place. So tomorrow, if this URL changes, okay, if URL changes, I will simply go to this centralized place and update the URL. For example, tomorrow URL 2 came. I'll simply update the URL 2 in the centralized place only once. This email also, the latest email I will update. Latest password I will update in the centralized place. So since all these automation tests are referring to the centralized place for this values of URL, email, password, only one time I need to update, guys. I don't have to open any test case. I just update the things in the centralized place, and the centralized place is accessed by all the automation tests. Is this a good approach or not, guys? What do you think? Is this a good approach or not? Yes, right? Yeah, that's correct. It's a very good approach. So this thing we can achieve with TestNG also. Okay, we can achieve this with TestNG. How to do that? Let me explain. Okay, how to achieve this centralized kind of thing with TestNG, and we call this concept in TestNG as TestNG parameterization. Okay, we call this as TestNG parameterization. Fine. So let's see how to do this. So copy this and paste it here. Suit level parameterization, that's fine. Other thing is other one is test level parameterization. Some code will be there mostly. Yeah, fine. So here we are going to use an annotation, this annotation, guys. Okay, so there I told you, right, TestNG has a lot of annotations. We have already discussed good number of annotations already. That is at the rate test. The last few sessions of TestNG I covered, right? Before method, at the rate, after method, at the rate, before class, at the rate, after class. Hope you practiced all these things. At the rate, before test, at the rate, after test, at the rate, before suite, at the rate, after suite. Like this, different. Yes, correct, correct. So all these are different TestNG annotations. So I told you, right, there are many more, right? There are many more TestNG annotations. So for achieving this parameterization, we have another annotation known as this one, at the rate parameters. Okay, at the rate parameters annotation. What is this annotation, guys? At the rate parameters. I'll tell you how to use this. I am going to show you right now. So here we have to do few changes to the testng.xml file to implement the parameterization. Fine. So this testng dot, here I am telling you, right, a centralized place. The centralized place is nothing but testng.xml. Understood, guys? I am going to make the centralized place as testng.xml. In testng.xml, I am going to put the, okay, I am going to put the things that should not be hard coded in each and every automation test. Okay, so I'll parameterize this kind of hard coded things. Should not be hard coded things. I am going to parameterize by making this testng.xml file a centralized place. Fine. Okay, so let's see what to do. So here we'll first open testng.xml file and let's see what is the status of this, and based on that we'll actually implement the parameterization. So 1 minute it will load. Yeah, this looks good. Only one test module is there, and inside this some classes are there, so that's a good sign. So under the suit we have to write something. Okay, you can refer this, guys. Okay, so you can refer the notes tomorrow. When you have to parameterize something, you simply open these notes and you just open these links. Then you'll get these things. Okay, you'll get these things. You don't have to remember anything, guys, because no one can remember everything, right? So how can someone remember this kind of syntaxes? It's not possible. So put something for reference, copy from there, paste into your things and get the things done. That's the only way, guys. Okay, you don't have to remember all the things. Just have to have an idea how to use. Whenever you get a problem, you should be able to quickly refer to the notes and get the things. Okay, like that. Or quickly Google search and refer that somehow. Okay, if you already have practiced, you'll get an idea when in real time when you get a problem. You can simply Google search, or you can actually refer to some notes or some lecture, some YouTube video or whatever it is, and get whatever you want. Let's say here parameterize. First of all, we have to parameterize, right? Fine. Only one thing I'm going to parameterize, guys, that this is the one. Okay. So what is the tag, guys? What is the tag we have to use in testengine.xml? Parameter tag. So under the inside the suit tag. So here we have the test module. In parallel with the test tag, we are going to create a parameter tag. Parameter. So parameter, we have to give the this particular thing. For example, you don't want this URL to be hard coded in automation test. You want to centralize this URL. You have to give parameter name is equal to name of the parameter you have to give. Okay, like this. Name is equal to URL. Value is equal to, okay. This value you should not hard code in the automation test. There are several automation tests here, right? If you see here, how many are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 tests are there. In 8 tests, I don't want to hard code this URL. Simply, I would like to parameterize here. Value is equal to, what is the value? Let's say this is the value I want to give. Okay, this is the value I want to give. Fine. So, fine. And one more thing I would like to do is I would like to divide this test module to two parts, guys. Okay. Test module to two parts. I would like to create another test module, test slash test. And to overcome this error, we have to copy these parts. Okay. I'll say test module. Some random thing I'm giving one. Here also I'll paste. I'll say test module 2. Fine. And I'll take out few things out of this, and 2 and 4 I will take. I'll take out 2 from here and paste it here, and I'll take out 4 from here and paste it here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We even have 8 here, right? Let's open 8. What is there in 8? Yeah, yesterday one example I have given. Right, that's fine. You cannot, that's okay. If you don't want 8 or want 8, that's fine. So we can put 8 also here if you want. Class, this is KPack. Class 8. What happened? Still, you are getting some error. Did I do any mistake anywhere? Slash, okay. So this is starting here and this is ending here. Slash test is there. Yeah, here you see there is the mistake is classes. I have to put these classes inside the test that was missing, right? Slash classes. Let's see whether this will be resolved. Yeah, this got resolved. Okay. Now say Control Shift F so that it will be formatted and organized properly and save. That's it. So we created something. Okay. So there are two test modules, and before this test modules came, we put a parameter here to parameterize. Okay. We want to make this testng.xml file a centralized place like this, a centralized place like this, where all the hard-coded things to avoid hard-coded things in the automation test, we'll put in the centralized place like this. We have to create parameters here. We are parameterizing the hard-coded values. Simple. Okay. Instead of hard-coding in each and every test, we are putting the hard-coded values in the testng.xml. So this concept is known as parameterization. So using the parameter tag, we have to do this. So after doing this, any test, just open any test, guys. And here you see this is a Maven thing. Let's open this. Let's see whether Selenium is already configured or not. Yes, Selenium is there. WebDriver Manager is there. SNG is there, everything is there, that's fine. So we'll do one thing. We'll write some code somewhere here and there. Okay. So here let's write some code. Web driver. Driver is equal to new Chrome driver. Web driver driver is called new Chrome driver. Over the mouse. Import web driver interface. Import Chrome driver class. Then before this, what we have to do? We have to say WebDriver manager dot Chrome driver dot setup. we have to say. Then we have to say driver dot manage dot window dot maximize. Then driver dot manage general steps, whatever we write, right? Manage dot timeouts dot implicitly wait 10 seconds time unit dot seconds. So these are the general basic steps that I generally write in the automation code. Then I will say driver dot get. This time I don't want to hard code the URL here. You understood, right? So this is the automation test, one of the automation tests. In this, I don't want to hard code the URL. What I have to do, guys? So I don't want to give the URL directly here. So if I give the URL here directly, what happened tomorrow? The URL changes. I have to come open this particular test and then modify here. Like similarly, there are many tests. If every test is using this kind of hard coded URL, so what happens, guys, tomorrow? I'll say thread dot sleep. I'll give some time, guys, so that we can see something in action. So just for demonstration purpose, I am adding thread dot sleep, add throws, and finally after that driver dot close. Driver dot close. Same thing I would like to put under here. Okay, here. I'm just copy pasting the code, guys. Assume that these are different codes. Okay, there are different automation tests. Assume that. So like these things are there. Assume that there are 100 tests, 1000 tests, and each and every test this URL is hard coded. So tomorrow this URL changes. I have to come to this particular place and update the URL. So here 4 tests are there. How many times I need to update, guys? If there are 4 tests, how many times I need to update the hard coded URL? If a URL changes, 4 times. If 1000 tests are 1000 tests, 1000 times. This is not a proper approach, right? We have to what we have to do? We have to parameterize. We have to parameterize. So in order to parameterize, we are using a central location known as testng.xml file. Here already we provided this URL. This URL need to be accessed. Okay. In this particular test, instead of providing this hard coded URL, we need to access the URL from testng.xml file from this parameter. How to do that? For that, I told you, right, there is an annotation. What is that annotation? @ parameters annotation. We have to write that annotation. So here you should not write in the brackets, guys. Okay, these are like attributes. But here annotation means before the test you have to write. So you have to say @ parameters. So just see the syntax, parameters. Now you have to provide this circular brackets beside the parameters. You have to provide over the mouse, import this parameter from which package? I have to import, guys, testng or BEST or junit. Tell me, guys, which package I need to import this? I have to import from, yes, testng, you are right, testng we have to import. Okay, just make sure that you don't select any wrong import thing. So put the circular brackets in that provide the curly brackets and provide the parameter. Here in testng already we created a parameter. The name of the parameter is URL. Copy this URL and put that inside this here, like this. Okay, so if you have multiple parameters, you can say, okay, like this, email, like this you can give, guys. Now at present we only have a single parameter, that is URL. So here this particular method only needs a single parameter, that is URL for now. So parameters, this in the curly brackets you can give URL. Okay, so once you give this URL, how to get this URL into this particular place? For that you have to do few changes. This is a method, right? Test one is a method. In this method you have to say what's the type of the URL? String, right? The value is string. So here you have to give a, okay, test one a, here you have to create something like this string. Say URL, okay, like this. This URL is different, this URL is different, right? So @ parameters, the first parameter will be coming to this first one. Okay, the first parameter will be coming to this first one. Test in method A, only one thing is there. This URL will be passed to this one. This URL, this URL, sorry, Let me copy this. Control C and just put that here. That's it. Understood, guys? So this parameter will be passed to this URL. Okay, this URL you have to use here. So now connection is built. So this particular test method is retrieving this URL from the testng.xml file. Okay, this URL will be passed to here. This URL will be passed to here. This URL will be used here. That's it. Nothing more than that. Fine. Similarly, here also we have to do the same thing. Here also hard coded value is there. What we have to do, guys, for this particular test, we have to do the same thing. We have to again say at the rate parameters and open the circular brackets. Inside the circular brackets, provide curly brackets and list down all the parameters. Here URL is a parameter. Only one parameter we have for now. That is URL. This URL we have to pass that to this method parameter, right? That is URL. This URL will pass here. That's it. Nothing more than that. Same thing you have to apply for all the things. One time, only one time effort. Tomorrow this URL changes, no problem. Things will work. We'll see that in action. Okay. I'll tell you how to I'll show you how this will work. Anyhow, I'll practically demonstrate anyhow. For now, let's do this. Parameters, circular brackets. Again, inside that curly brackets. Here URL parameter, which is actually provided in testng.xml file. Here we have to say string URL. You can give any name here, guys. URL, URL to whatever it is. Okay, whatever you give here, you just have to paste it here. Nothing more than that. It will work. Still work. At the rate parameters, circular brackets, four times. This is one time effort I have to do, guys. Tomorrow, if URL changes, I don't have to do anything. Okay, one time if you set up this kind of things, fine. Yes, same URL if you are using in all classes, right? Generally in automation projects, we'll have a single URL only, right? Single URL only. So there's a possibility that URL may change. There's a possibility that URL may change. So fine, anything. This is just to show that this URL should be used here, okay? This URL should be used here. This URL should be used here. You can give any name, URL or URL 1, URL 2, whatever it is, okay? So just. That's okay. You can give any name for this parameter, method parameter also. Fine. So that's it. That's it. Now, if I run this class1.java, what will happen, guys? If I run this class1.java, what will happen? Will this script work or not? Will this particular @ parameters will be able to get this this URL value from this centralized location on a testng.xml file and pass it here or not? We have to check it, right? So for that, let's check it. So let's run only class1.java. Right click run as testng test. Let's see what will happen. You got an error. There is a reason why error is coming here, guys. There is a reason why error is coming. The reason is when you parameterize something, you should not run individually. Okay. You cannot run the classes individually. Once you parameterize something in the testng.xml file, you should not be running this particular test individually using the class names. What we have to do, guys, we have to run only the testng.xml file. Then only this parameterization will work. Understood, guys? What I am saying, you are understanding, right? When parameterization is done like this, all the things are like you created some parameter here and classes, you are accessing the parameters. In that case, you should not be running the individual classes like this. This will give errors. Okay. So what we have to do? We have to run the testng.xml file only. Run right click run as testng suit. Then only it will work, guys. Okay, when parameterization is done, only possibility is you have to run the testng.xml file. You see, things will work. All the four tests will open the you see everything will work. Okay, everything one by one. You see. So if the application URL is opening, that means parameterization is successful already, right? Parameterization is successful already. You're able to access the URL from the centralized place, each and every test case, we didn't hard code anything now. In the automation test, we didn't hard code the URLs. So only thing is that we created a single parameter in the testng.xml centralized place, and from the testng.xml file, we are accessing the URL required for all the automation tests wherever required. Okay, this is how we have to parameterize. Fine, you see all the test cases got passed and everything is fine. So I got a question here from Krish saying, so in the case where client asks for specific test cases, what is supposed to be done? Yeah, that's it. You have to modify that. We have to customize our testng.xml file. Okay, we have to customize our testng.xml file and run that. You got it right, Krish? So if parameterization is done, if client is asking for running some specific test case, you can actually copy paste case. Okay, you don't have to depend on a single testng.xml file. You can copy this again, paste it, and tomorrow you can name it as testng2 or something. And okay, in this, whatever the test case that client is asking, only that you put it. For example, client is only asking for class 1. Okay, client is only asking for class 1. Remaining thing, just remove that. So you can create any number of testng.xml files, not a problem. Just remove all the remaining things, save it. Now run this, right click, run as testng suit. That's it, it will work. So fine. I was able to explain that. Okay, I was able to explain that you will be able to copy also in the upcoming content. That's fine. As the question came, I am explaining now. Okay, so we can copy paste the testng.xml files as many number of times as you want, and in each and every testng.xml file you can put whatever the test cases you want to put. Okay, here only 4 test cases will run because we are only running class 1. We're only running class 1, guys, right? Only 4 test cases will run, remaining all test cases will not be run. So like this we can do whatever you want. Okay, lot of flexibility is there in testng.xml file. Fine, done, that's it. How many test cases? Only 4 test cases. Okay, because class 1 only we provided in the testng.xml file. So here now we have multiple testng.xml files. Based on the client requirements, we can create as many number of testng.xml files, and okay, whatever you can name it properly also. Okay, based on your requirement you can name them. You don't have to put the testng.xml file every time. This testng name can be changed, guys, not a problem. Fine, test smoke test, regression test, like that you can give the name for the testng.xml files, not a problem. Fine, anyhow, this is how we can parameterize the things. Okay, this is how we can parameterize the things. Now so far I explained only suit level parameterization, suit level. Okay, at a high level, what if I give some test level? So we'll do one more thing before going there. That is, the requirement here is, here this tests are using, we have parameterized here, we cannot update anything URL, we will not update here. Tomorrow the URL changed. Earlier the URL was omaya.blogspot.com. Tomorrow the URL changed to some other URL. Let's say the URL got changed to this one. A new URL came. So where I have to update, guys? This URL I have to run my automation scripts now. Earlier I used to run my automation scripts on Omaya. Now I have to run my automation scripts on tutorialsninja.com/demo. Latest URL came for the application, and I need to update it. So do I have to go to the automation test and update, or what is the best way? Where I have to update, guys? The URL, if it is changed. Yes, you are right, Krish. We have to do that in testng.xml file. Yes, Karan, you are also right. We have to go to testng.xml file, simply change this URL only once here. That's it, and save. You are done, guys. Okay, now run this just go to the required testng.xml file and change it here. That's it, and whatever the XML file, you just run it, right click, run as testng suit. That's it. You see, this time your automation scripts will run on the latest application URL, okay, not the older application URL. You see, single change all the automation tests will get updated. You don't have to go to each and every automation test and update the URL. This concept is known as parameterization. Okay, in testng we call that as testng parameterization, where you are going to use testng.xml file as a centralized file where you'll put all the parameters and avoid hard coding in the individual automation tests. So the good practice that you have to follow in automation while automation is you should not hard code any values. Okay, you should not hard code any values in real time. Fine guys, everything got executed and everything is successfully run. That's fine. Now, so far whatever I explained is suit level parameterization. Okay, there is something like test level parameterization also there. Test level, what does it mean? For example, at suit level you gave this parameter, the same parameter at test level you are giving another URL. Okay, so what will happen? You can give the parameters at the suit level or test level, guys. That's what is a thing. For example, in class 1, where is class 1? You see, in this test, original testng.xml file, we have two test modules, right? There are two test modules. This one, this parameter is at which level? It is directly under the suit, not inside the test modules. That means it is a kind of global thing, right? Here, whatever you provide, it will become global for these test modules. All these test modules will use this parameter because it is at a high level. Directly under suit, it is there. But what if I move this parameter? Okay, what if I provide this parameter here like this inside the test? Inside the test, I will put, instead of at the suit level, I will put there the test level. So what it will happen at the test level? This will be applied. So this will not be applied. This particular parameter, for example, if I put instead of this here, if I put here, what will happen? It cannot be accessed, guys. Class one belongs to class one, which is actually using this URL, right? Belongs to which test module? Class one belongs to which test module, guys? Test module one or test module two? Class one belongs to which test module? Yes, test module one. But parameterization is done at which level? Test module level. But test module two. So do you think this parameter can be accessed by class one now? Since the parameter is provided at test module level, can this parameter be accessed by the class one? Things will not work, right? Things will not work now. This will not work. So do that. Just check that. Right click run as testng suit. So things will fail. You see, failing because you cannot access the parameter, which because it is at the test level. What we have to do at the test level required? We have to do that. Okay, we have to provide that at the test level. Because class one needs this tutorials.com or some whatever it is. Okay, so you have to give that here. If I give, you can give any URL here. That's fine for now. I'll give this URL. So you see, test module one will use omaya.blogspot.com, whereas test module two will use tutorialsninja.com. So in one of the test module two, we have class two, class four is there. We'll open a class four and we'll try to provide a parameter here at the rate parameters circular brackets, open the curly brackets, put the URL, import this parameter testng string method parameter URL, so my cursor got changed somehow. Yeah, fine, I copy pasted. You see what will happen, guys? This class 4 belongs to test module 2. This class 4 will use tutorialsninja.com/demo, whereas class 1 belongs to test module 1. Class 1 will use omaya.blogspot.com. okay, instead of having all these things, right, we'll do one thing. I'll comment out all these things, okay, so that this will not be executed. It will waste our time, guys, so I'm doing that. So only one test is there in class one. Let's assume only one test is there in class four. So class one will use which parameter, guys? Which URL? Class four will use which URL? Here class one will use omaya.blogspot.com, whereas class four will use tutorialsninja.com/demo. So you see, we can actually parameterize at the test level. At the test level also, we can parameterize. This is the example, guys. Okay, let's run this testng.xml file. Right click run as testng suit. Different tests will use different URLs. So one of the tests is using omaya.blogspot.com. This will be class one. So another test somewhere will be using class four, I guess. Will be using tutorialsninja.com/demo. Okay, class four, class one, fine. Class one was using Omaya. Class four was using tutorialsninja.com. So because we have given the parameterization at the test level. Clear, guys? Is it clear? These concepts are clear for you. Parameterization concepts. So we should not run the test individually, guys. I already told you, right? You should not run the test individually. If you try to run the individually, when parameterization is done, you should not run the test individually. You'll get errors. Fine. So guys, this is all about parameterization. So I'll remove these parameters, guys. I don't want to keep these parameters. Okay. We are done with the topic. So I'm just removing the parameters and making my code clean again. So I'll avoid these parameters now. Okay, remove this. All parameters I am removing so that I can explain next concepts without any confusion for you. Okay, let me remove. Anywhere else I have parameterized things. Control Shift O. I'll remove this code now. I don't want to put this code. Okay. So. Just cleaning my code. That's it. And also I'll delete this testng2.xml. Fine. Things are good now. So we have to go to the next topic, guys. Parameterization for passing multiple data to the specified test. Okay, guys. So next topic is parameterization for passing multiple data to the specified test. Okay. So let's say there is a test. Let's say there is one test, guys. We'll create the test here. Right click new class. Some class 9 or something we'll create here. Inside this class, we have one test. I'll create some test. Some test 9 or something. Okay. And here I have to make, this is a normal method. I have to annotate this with @test_annotation so that this will become a test case. Automation test it will become. That's it. This is now an automation test. Inside this, I'll write some code. Inside this, I'll write some code. Okay. But guys, this particular test need to be run multiple times with different sets of data. You're getting my point, right? The same test case need to be run 3 times. Assume that I want to run this particular test case 3 times, each time with different sets of data. Each time with different sets of data. Let's say this particular test is like login test. Username password will be there, right? String username will be there. String password is there. So I would like to pass different username and different password 3 times. Okay, a combination of username and password 3 times I will pass. This particular same test should run 3 times. Okay, this particular same test should run 3 times, which each set of data this should write 3 times. Okay, this each set of data it should run 3 times. So how can this be possible? Okay, we are driving the data with the help of data-driven testing. This concept is known as data-driven testing, guys. Let me explain. There's something known as data-driven testing. What is data-driven testing? Let's let's take an example, guys. Okay, so that you'll understand this. Let's say there is a website for school. Okay, there is a website for school. So this website can be accessed by mainly three different roles. One is admin team. There may be admin team of the school, like whether the students have paid the fees and all those stuff. Okay, so there may be some other people like teachers. Teachers will access this. So teachers, why they will access this school website? This is a school website. Teachers will, admin team will log into the website for administration purposes, for adding the teachers, for adding the students. Okay, for adding the students, for adding the teachers. Admin team will add the students when they pay the fees and all those stuff. Okay, so admin team will make sure that all the students have received the books and all those stuff. All the activities to be done by admin team. Admin team has to log into the website with their credentials, that is username and password of the admin team, and then add the teachers. They can do a lot of stuff. Okay, you can imagine. But teachers will log into the website with an intention of training the students, giving assignments to the students, giving homework, or all the other things. Okay, interacting with the students and all those stuff. Why students will log into the website? Students will log into the same school website. Okay, let's say the functionality is login for now. Okay, students will log into the website with an intention of other things, like they want to attend the teacher trainings, or they want to submit the assessments, all those things. So here login test case is same. Test is same, login test is same, but how many types of user roles are there? Three user roles. This admin will have its own username and password. Teachers will have their own username and password. Students will have their own username and password. Now, I want to check whether all these user roles are able to log into the application. So do I have to write this automation test three times? So do I have to test this automation test? You have to write this automation login test three times, so that one automation test will be used by admin team. Another automation test where we'll pass the teacher credentials and test. Another automation test will pass the student credentials and test. Different automation tests are required, or only one test will be good? What do you think, guys? Single test will be good, or multiple tests will be good for each and every credential? Tomorrow 1,000 credentials will come. Do you create 1,000 test cases for each and every username and password? You will create 1,000 test cases. What do you think? Single will be good, guys. Yes, guys. Single is good. So there may be a requirement for you guys in real time. You may get a requirement something like this. Some login functionality is there. Okay. Some login test is there, which index username and password. Let's say login test method, which takes like this username, password. Okay, and there is a sheet, guys. There is an Excel sheet, or there is something, not an Excel sheet. There is some place where 1,000 usernames and passwords are provided, and your requirement is to, client is asking you to test all these usernames and passwords are working or not. You just need to pass this username and password to this login test and check whether all these 1,000 usernames and passwords are working or not. Do you write 1,000 tests, or single test will be good? What do you think, guys? Single test or 1,000 tests? Same login test, but 1,000 usernames and passwords are there. So if you write 1,000 tests, it will waste your time like anything, and that's not a good approach. We have to go with the single test approach. That means the same test case need to be invoked how many times? The same test case need to be invoked how many times? Here 1,000 usernames and passwords. How many times we need to call this test case? 1,000 times. That's what we have to do. This kind of testing is known as data-driven testing. Okay, the single test case will be driven by 1000 data-driven testing. Okay, guys. So understood, guys. What is data-driven testing? Understood? Clear? Fine. Let's go into the practical mode now. Okay. Now you understood the concept why data-driven testing is needed and all. So I will not take 1000 usernames and password because okay. I will take only 3 usernames and passwords and something like that. And I will try to. This is possible with the TestNG, guys. We can achieve data-driven testing with TestNG. Okay. And here also parameterization concept is used for this also for passing multiple data set to the specified test. Here another annotation is coming into picture. Just observe that. Apart from the whatever the annotations we have, at the rate test, at the rate before suit, after suit, and at the rate parameter size also covered. Now another annotation, that is at the rate. What is that annotation, guys? At the rate data provider annotation. We are going to use this annotation now to achieve this data-driven testing. Using TestNG, we have to use this annotation known as at the rate data provider. Let me show you how to use that. So here is a code, guys. Let me open this code. First, let's create some data. Okay, this test method is already there. For example, here test 9 is there. Some application login. Okay, some login is there. Login test. Some login test method is there. It can be of any application, that's fine. It actually indexes username and password. Okay, this is the test method. Here you see, this is the test method. This is a test method which actually indexes username and password. So here I'll say something like this: system.out.println. User got logged in successfully logged in using username. Which username? This particular username. Okay. Plus username. And password. Which password? This password. I'll write like this. Fine. This is a normal test. And so this normal test need to receive data from a different place. That is going to be a method. We are going to create something like this. Get data method. Public void get data. You can give any name here, guys. Not only get data, you can give get okay, information, anything, any name you can give. I'm just choosing get data for now. That's okay. Get data. Inside this method, we need to create an object array, two-dimensional object array. Object, okay, A is equal to, or data is equal to new object. I'm going to provide the size of this object, guys. 3 sets of data. I would like to, if you want to pass 1000 sets of data, you have to give 1000 here. Okay, just, you already know object array, guys. When I explained arrays concept, I explained about object, right? Object array can store any type of values, numerical values, string values. If you are specifying object for the arrays can store. For example, if I give integer array, this integer array A is equal to new int of some 3 or something. So this integer array will only accept integer values, right? If I give char array, this char array will store only char values. Only character values will be allowed here. But object array can store all type of values. That's why object. Instead of giving int or something here, I'm giving object. Okay. If I give int here, it will only store integer objects, integer values. If I give object here, it can store any type of values. That's why object array. Okay. Object array, if you don't remember this correctly, just refer to the previous session, guys, where I explained about arrays. In one of the previous session, I explained about arrays. Just go through that and understand this object array concept. If I give 1000 here, what is happening? 1000 sets of username and password I need to pass. I don't want to pass that many. I just want to pass 3 sets of data. That's fine. And how many are there? Username and password, how many are there? If I count this two are there, right? So I have to put two here. Three sets of data, and each set of data has two things to be passed. I need to pass username password. So two, only two. Three sets of data, and each set of data will be two only. Each set of data will have two values. So here, data of zero. First set of data, zero index. First value is equal to. I need to pass username. Let's say I am passing the username as Arun. Okay. Now, first set of data only, but second value. Here username already passed to the first set. This first set of data index is zero means first set. The first set first value is Arun. That is username is Arun. Second value is password. So here password is say 12345. Some dummy data I am giving guys. Now, first set of data is done out of this three. So second set of data, index one will be there. Second set of data, in that first value is say Varun. These are advanced concepts, guys. This will take some time, so you have to be very patient and understand the things. Password is some 4567. Then how many sets of data I told? Three sets of data. Two sets of data already done. Third set of data I am providing. Data of two, of zero. Say Tarun. Data of two of one. Some password 9123. Some password. That's it, guys. So three sets of data I created. But this set of data should be passed to this method. How to pass? First of all, this particular method should return something. You have to say return this data. This data has three sets of data. Okay, this object array has three sets of data. I'm just returning this data. When I return this data, I'll get this error because the return type is mentioned as void here, which should be changed to object array. So automatically it will change over the mouse, change method type return type to object two dimensional array. That's it. Okay. If you are returning this object array, the return type should be same. So simply do this process. That's it. Now, this particular method, which is going to supply the data to this particular method, should be made something. That is, we have to annotate this particular method, which is going to supply the data to this test method as, with which annotation? Data provider. This is going to provide, this method is going to provide the data. That's why we have to annotate this data provider. Import this data provider from test engine. Now, officially, this method is going to supply the data to the required methods. Fine. That's why it is a data provider method. This is the place from which we are supplying the data. First step is done. Now, here we have one attribute, guys. To connect this particular test case to this data provider method, we have an attribute. The attribute also looks similar. That is data provider attribute. Here capital D is there, here small d is there. Okay, at the rate data provider. This annotation, this is an attribute. This is attribute, guys, not annotation. Okay. You have to say data provider is equal to what we have to do, guys. Data provider is equal to the name of the data provider method we have to provide. What is the name? Get data. Just provide that get data here. That's it. This connection is established now. Okay. So here this particular test method need to get the data from this data provider. For that, we have to provide this attribute at this test method. So we have to say data provider is equal to from which data provider method you want to get the data. That method name we have to provide. This get data provider method we have to provide here. That's it. The connection has been established between this data provider method and the test method. So when you get the data, automatically this data will be going into username. This data will go to password. Second set of data also same thing. This will go to username. This will go to password. Three times this particular test method will be called by data provider method three times because three sets of data is there. Change it to four times this method will be called. So let's run this and see what is happening. What is this method, guys? Class 9, right? right click on this class name, say run as test ng test. How many times? 3 times it has to run. You see, same test method is executed 3 times. You see, what is the method that got executed? Test method, login test. The same login test got executed how many times? 3 times. So first time, which data is passed to this login test? Arun 12345. Second time, when the login test is called by this data provider method, it has passed Varun 4567. Third time, when the login test has been called by this data provider, the data provider has passed Tarun 9123. Okay, 3 sets of data has been passed. The output also, you got the user got successfully logged in using username Arun, password 12345. User got successfully logged in using username Varun and password 4567. User got successfully logged in using username Tarun and password. So if thousand data is there, what do you have to do, guys? Here you have to give 1000. Okay, 1000 usernames and passwords you have to give, and this data provider method will actually call this test method 1000 times. If 1000 sets of data are there, this test method will be called 1000 times. You don't have to create this test method 1000 times. Okay, only one time. Simply by putting 1000 here and providing the 1000 sets of data here as input, okay, this particular test method will run 1000 times. So clear, guys, how to achieve, okay, how to achieve data driven testing with the help of TestNG. Is it clear, guys? Did you understand, guys, how to achieve data driven testing with the help of TestNG? Yes, but practice, guys. Okay, but practice, things are good, but just practice it, fine. So next advanced concept is TestNG listener, guys. Okay, TestNG listeners. Let me explain. So what are TestNG listeners? Next advanced concept of TestNG is TestNG listeners. Okay, TestNG listeners. What are TestNG listeners? Suppose you have written some automation code. Okay, here let me explain. Let's say here you have written some automation code. You have written some automation code. This is your Selenium automation code. Driver dot get, driver dot do something, driver dot close. All those things are there here. Assume that. So somehow, at one point of time, the test got failed. This particular test got failed, guys. So when test got failed, what we have to do? What we have to do when test got failed? We have to say TestNG assertions, right? We have to fail the TestNG assertion. We have to put some TestNG assertion and fail it. Let's say in this automation script, using the assertions, assert dot fail has come and the test got failed. Some assertion is there and then failed. The test got failed. Let's say, okay. Here we have put some TestNG assertion. You know about TestNG assertion, right? Assert dot assert equals, assert dot assert true, assert dot assert fail. I explained in one of the previous session, right, of TestNG only. So when such but kind of statement fails, so when such kind of statement fails, what we have to do? We have to immediately take a screenshot, right? We have to take a screenshot here. We have to take a screenshot. Apart from screenshot, what we have to do? We have many other things we can do, okay? We can report, we can add this failure thing into the report, okay? So we can actually do logs and all those stuff. These things I'm going to cover, guys. Reporting and logs I'm going to cover in the upcoming sections, okay? In the upcoming topics, I'm going to cover reporting and logs. You already know screenshots, right? Screenshots I already explained to you in one of the sessions. So when something fails, immediately you have to take a screenshot. You have to report, you have to mark this particular test as failed in the report. You have to put some logs into the logs. All those things need to be done. Okay, so such kind of thing, how can you do this when something fails here? How can screenshot be automatically taken? How can screen report can be updated? How can logs can be taken? So with help of something known as listeners, okay, listeners will listen to your code. When something is happening, listeners will listen to your code. And when such kind of events occur, like failure kind of events or something occur, okay, based on the events, listeners will perform taking the screenshots, reporting and logs. Fine, guys. So listeners will listen to your code. when you create the listeners in TestNG, when you create the listeners will continuously listen to your code and perform necessary actions like taking screenshots, failing tests, etc., etc. Okay, so when some failure happens, immediately listeners will take the screenshot, not you. Okay, listeners will take the screen. You'll understand that. You'll understand what are listeners in when I practically explain the things, right? You'll easily understand. But at a high level, understand listeners will continuously listen to your code and see what is happening in your code. When such kind of events like failure events, such kind of events happen, based on our configurations in listeners, listeners will take the screenshots for us. We'll actually update the reports, we'll update the logs and all those other things. Whatever you want to do, it will do. Okay. So listeners will listen to the code. What are listeners, guys? Listeners will listen to your automation code and perform necessary actions as configured. Okay, as you configured in the listeners, they will perform necessary actions when such kind of events occur in the automation code. Listeners will listen to your code. When such kind of required actions is done, then they will perform necessary actions according to the events arised as per the configuration done in the listeners. Fine, guys. So let's configure listeners, guys. Okay, let's configure listeners. Okay, so add the required methods. 1 minute. Let me copy this and open somewhere. So this is a high test listener. That's fine. So on test start, success, failure, on test skipped. Fine. Okay, so what I will do here is I'll remove all this stuff, guys. I think I don't need this. Let me check if I need all these things. Yeah, let them be there. Let's create any this is fine. I don't think we should having any problem here. We'll open one of the tests. Okay, fine. Or else I'll create a new package without any confusions. New package, IJK ppack. Under this package, I will create a new class. Just to avoid your confusions, guys, I am doing this. Right click new class, say class 10. Finish. Here I will create a method, guys. Public void test 10. I'll convert this method to @test method. Test case. So here I'll write some automation code. That is, I'll write something like this. Web driver. Driver is equal to new Chrome driver. Over the mouse, import web driver. Over the mouse, import Chrome driver. Now, here before this, I have to say web driver manager dot. It's not coming. Yeah, R is missing. Web driver manager dot Chrome driver dot setup. So here driver dot manage dot window dot driver dot get. I will say first driver dot get. I'll open this application URL. It's fine. Then driver dot manage dot window dot maximize. So here I need to see this code, guys. On test start, this will be coming. On test success, this will be coming. On test failure, this will be coming. On test skip, this will be coming. Fine. Okay. So driver dot manage dot timeouts dot implicitly wait 10 time unit dot seconds. Okay, time unit dot seconds. That's it. Fine. Fine, great. So what next? Next is here the test execution has started here, right? Test execution has started here. Test execution has started here. That's fine. Next is there are three possibilities, right? There are three possibilities. Here I'll give something, guys. Int a is equal to some one. I'm giving, okay. If a is equal to one, if a is equal to one, I'm just writing this logic just to make sure that just to make sure whether our listener is working or not. Okay. What is the purpose of listeners, guys? Listeners will listen to your code. Okay. Listeners will listen to your code based on the events occurred. They will perform actions. So I want to create the events. If a is equal to one, I want to create some event. Say assert dot assert true. Okay. Assert dot assert true. Here I'll give int b is equal to 5, comma c is equal to 6. B less than c. What will happen, guys? If I say assert dot assert true, what will happen? B less than 6. True, right? True. Means the test will pass. Simple this. Test will pass. If else, if a is equal to 2, I want to fail the test. If I give a as 2 here, what will happen? This particular test will fail, guys. This particular test will fail. Assert dot assert true. Here I'll give b greater than c. B greater than c will result in false. So when something false is coming, this will fail, right? It is expecting true, but false is coming, so it will fail. When a is equal to, it will fail. Else if a is equal to 3, I'll say throw new, skip exception. I explained all these things, guys. Assert true, assert false, assert true. All those things I explained in the event. Skip exception also I explained. Okay. Test skipped. Some message I'm writing over the mouse. Import this from test engine. So based on the values that you pass to A, either the test may pass or test may fail. Okay. If one is passed, test will pass. If 2 is passed to A, test will fail. If 3 is passed to A, test will be skipped. So 3 actions will be performed, right? So I have intentionally created this automation code so that, okay, finally at the end I will say driver dot close or something. Okay, fine. This is a sample automation script, guys. This automation script will create some action events here. This is a pass event, this is a failure event, this is a skip event. Based on these events, based on these events, our listener class that I'm going to create now will listen to this code, and based on the events raised, it will perform necessary actions. We'll see that in action. Okay, so for that, guys, we'll create another class, another we have to create a class. Let me create a class. Right click, new class, known as listeners. Anything is fine, you can give any name. I'll give listeners. Click on finish. This class I want to write some code here. Because of that, this listeners class will listen to the whatever is happening in the test method. Okay, this listeners class has to listen to the test method. So in this listeners class need to import something known as iTestListener. Okay, this listeners class need to implement iTestListeners interface. So how to implements iTestListener. Import this from TestNG, guys. This iTestListener is an interface from TestNG. So when you create some listeners class, this listeners class need to implement iTestListener interface so that you can use this, you can implement the methods of this iTestListener interface. So what does this iTestListener interface will contain? For that, let's go here, testng.org. Where can we find the documentation of TestNG, guys? Java doc, API documentation. Go here and search for what? We have to search for this interface, iTestListener. iTestListener will have some predefined kind of methods. So we have to implement them. Control F, आई टेस्ट लिसनर. ओके हियर इट इज आई टेस्ट लिसनर, हियर इट इज. लेट्स ओपन दिस इंटरफेस इन द टेस्ट एनजी एपीआई गाइस. टेस्ट एनजी एपीआई वी हैव दिस आई टेस्ट लिसनर इंटरफेस. गो डाउन, यू सी देयर आर फ्यू मेथड्स ऑन फिनिश, ऑन स्टार्ट, ऑन सक्सेस, ऑन फेल्यूर, ऑन स्किप्ड. ओके विल नॉट टेक एवरीथिंग, विल टेक मोस्ट ऑफ देम. सो ऑन स्टार्ट विल यूज फर्स्ट. ओके विल यूज ऑन स्टार्ट. I will implement this on start. Public void. What is the method, guys? On start method. Copy this on start. So here, I test context we have to use, right? This method has I test context. Use it. I test context context. So here I have my sample code untested. I test result. We can also use I test result also, not a problem. I test result we'll use better. And result fine. So whatever the methods that are there in the I test listener, we are going to use. Import this I test result. That's fine. The reason why I test result is being used here, I'll tell you later. Okay. For now, just understand this. We created a listener class. And this listeners class is implementing the predefined interface of TestNG, that is iTestListener. This iTestListener has some predefined methods. OnStart is one of the method. We are implementing them. System.out.println. Here I'll write test execution started. I'll simply write test execution started. I'm not going to explain about iTest result. I will explain later, guys. For now, ignore. Okay. For now, ignore this iTest result. This will be used later. So for now, when this particular method is invoked. Okay, when this particular method is invoked, test execution started. Just understand this, guys. When you are running this particular test, execution started here, right? This particular test execution started at this point. When the execution started, automatically this listener will listen to this particular test and see that okay, test execution started. So automatically listeners class will invoke on start and perform this action. Whatever you provide in this particular method, that will happen, guys. Let's say you want to print this two times. This will happen. Okay. When onStart method of the listeners is invoked, when this test method has started, automatically this onStart method of the listeners class will be invoked, and whatever that you write inside this onStart will be executed. So here, if you write this two times, it will be printed two times. If you write only one time, it will be printed one time, like that, guys. When the test started, this onStart method will be automatically invoked, and whatever you write inside this onStart will be executed. Next thing. So test engine listen, these are important concepts, guys. Okay, whatever I'm explaining today are important concepts. So interviewers will ask you difficult questions only. They will not ask simple questions. So if you are good at this kind of advanced topics, you will be able to answer every interview question. Okay, if you are good at these concepts, you can answer almost all questions given triggered by the interviewer. Okay, that's why you have to learn test engine. Test engine is very important in interviews, guys. Okay, not only Java. Lot of interviewers will ask lot of questions from TestNG also. Okay, because it's an important, it plays an important role in framework development. So we have to learn TestNG to this extent. Complete TestNG I'm covering, guys, in my sessions. So you don't have to go anywhere. Simply practice this and get ready for interviews or your real time needs. Okay, if you understand all this term, all these things, you can easily work with the TestNG frameworks. I mean related frameworks. So we are now at the TestNG listeners. I am explaining the TestNG listeners. Very simple concept, guys. Not much. There is sample automation script, and we created listeners class which will actually listen to this script. Okay. Since this listeners class is implementing the iTest listener interface, we can implement some methods of the interface in this kind of listeners class. And all this listeners class, once listening to this method, this test method, and if the execution starts, it will actually invoke on start and perform this action, which is in the onStart. Similarly, there are other methods, right? In the library, we have other methods also. Apart from onStart, we have on. Okay, I think we have to use onTestStart, guys, and not onStart. Okay, onTestStart, I guess. So let me confirm it. Yeah, this is not onStart. It is onTestStart. So we should use onTestStart, not onStart. Okay, so that's why there's a confusion. It has iResult. Okay, iTestResult. Second is after on test start at the end of the script. Okay, this execution started at the end of the script after this driver dot close. Test script, test execution finished here. Finished here. At this point, if you want to invoke any method, okay, if you at this point of time, if you want to, if listeners want to do something at the end of the test, okay, so for that we have some other method right here. As you can see in the library, we have on finish, but this is ITEST context. I don't know whether we can use or not. We'll try to use, not a problem, and see what is happening. Public void on test finish, ITEST context. Context, it's up to us whether we want to use this context or not. That's fine. Text execution, when the test execution has completed, automatically listeners will listen to this particular automation code and invoke this on finish. Okay, whatever you write inside this on finish will be performed here. Test execution ended. Okay, save. That's it. Next thing, on test start is completed, on finish is completed. Now there are three possibilities. Either the test will be successful, okay, on test success, or the test will be failed, or the test will be skipped. These three actions I'll try to implement. First I will implement on test success. Public void on test success. System.out.println. Test execution successful. Okay, test execution successful. That's it. So this will be printed in the output. Okay, whatever you write in this will be printed. When test fails, okay, public void here. Generally, when some test fails, right, generally what we'll do, we'll take a screenshot. I'm not going to write any code for taking a screenshot now, because I already explained in the previous session. Here we can generally write a code for taking the screenshot, updating the failure status into the test reports. All these kind of actions we can do here, guys, but I'm not going to write any code. Just assume that we are going to write some code for these kind of things. Whatever the things, update in logs. I'll explain what are logs, what are reports, and all those things I'm going to explain in the upcoming sections. For now, just these are the things that you generally do when something fails. You will take a screenshot, we'll update the test reports as failure. Okay, some logs will be collected. In that logs also will say this particular test got failed, something like that. Okay, all those things will perform, but here I'm not doing that. I'm simply writing a dummy statement like system.out.println test execution, just to make sure whether this particular method is invoked or not. I'm just writing this print statement. Execution failed. What is that one more thing, guys? Guys, what is the remaining thing I have to write? Apart from all this, on start is done, on finish is on test start is done, on finish is done, on test success is done, on test failure is done. What is the remaining thing, guys, that I need to implement now? Yes, you are right, Karan. Skipped. On test skipped. So public void on test skipped. Guys, I am taking these sessions very slow, because you know, right, these are advanced topics. I understand that this will actually, okay, like if I take it slow, right, then only you will understand this. Just focus on, because I am taking too much of time to make you understand these things. Test got skipped. Test execution got skipped. So are we done? So here we have created listeners class. It's implementing ITEST listeners, and so based on the different actions that may come out as an outcome from this test method, I created some methods. These listeners will listen to this particular automation code. Based on the actions, events arise, these listeners will invoke appropriate methods like on test start, on finish, on test success, on test value, on test script, and print something for us. Okay. But this is not done, guys. The configuration of listeners is not done yet. One more thing we have to do. Okay. In order for this listeners class to work, we have to do one more thing. What is that one more thing? We have to tweak the testng.xml file a bit. Okay. We have to customize the testng file a bit, guys. So copy this. We have to add some listeners tags, guys. So don't think that just create a test method, just create this listeners, everything is done. Okay, we have to connect this listeners to the test, right? Then only things will work. You have to connect this listeners to the test, then only things will work. Otherwise it will not work. Otherwise it will not work, guys. Fine. So how to connect this listeners to this class? For that we need to tweak testng.xml file. So I'm going to make this testng.xml file a bit simple. So I'll try to copy this and create another version of testng.xml file here. Say testng.2, testng2.xml. That's fine. I'm going to use this XML. Okay, instead of original testng, I'm going to use testng2.xml. Here, what is that new class I created? Class 10, right? So only class 10 I'll put. Okay, remaining things I'll simply remove this part. I'll simply say class 10. This is ppack, right? In ppack we have class 10. So remaining all these things I'll remove. So this particular testng.xml file looks very simple now. Suit is there, one test is there, that's it, nothing more than that. Okay, this one I am going to modify so that I can connect listeners to the class 10. Just for demonstration I am doing, guys, nothing more than that. Just to make your understanding more simple, I am doing this. Fine. So this is a thing that I have to open. This is already done, that's fine. This also you understood, just close this. Fine. So here is a test, whatever the changes we have to do to testng.xml file are there here. This is a part, guys. Okay, this part we need. This part you just need to focus. You have to add the listeners tags to your listeners. listeners, listeners tags you have to add. Inside this listeners tag there is a listener tag again. Add this. Okay, as I don't remember everything, guys. Okay, you don't have to remember everything, you just need to copy paste, because a lot of stuff is there in testng or any other things, you cannot remember everything. So listener class name is equal to something, just copy paste this syntax for now. Class name is equal to, what is the class name, guys? Where is listeners class available? Where is this listeners class available? That class you have to provide. Under ppack only we have this, right? Listeners class is under ppack. It can be any other package also. You can move this if you want, you can move to opac, not a problem. Okay, now listeners is under opac. I'll delete from here, I'll close from here and delete from here so that you will understand what's happening. Okay, so listeners is under opac. So opac I will give. Listener is under opac. Opac dot listeners dot, okay, so what next I have to give, guys? Here I'll just see project name I have to give. Okay, package name, project name. What is the project name here? Project name is MVT project. Give the same project name, MVT project. Opac, under opac we have listeners class now. MVT project, listeners. I think name is listeners. That's fine. That's it. Listeners is a class name. Listeners is a class name. So listeners class is under this opac, and the project name is MVT project. I don't know whether we have to give this project name here. I don't think we have to give this, guys. This will be enough, I guess. Okay, let's see whether if it will not work, we'll check that. Okay, first we have to give the package name, that is opac, and the class name listeners. This will be enough, guys. Class name, this will be enough. You don't have to give much. You don't have to give the project name. Opac dot listeners you have to give. That's it. Then listeners you configured successfully now, and this class is also mentioned. That's fine. Save it. So we'll do something now. Let's see our luck whether this is working or not. Now let me run this code, guys. What I have to run, guys? Guys, what I have to run? Now testng2.xml file is ready. Class 10 is ready. What I have to run? Listeners class is run ready. What I have to run? I have to run testng2.xml file. Right click on testng2.xml file. We mentioned class 10, which has this code, and listeners are also mentioned, right? Run this testng2.xml file and see what is happening. We got an exception. Okay, maybe we have to give the project name MVT project. Let's see. Here opac, under which listeners class is there, and this is the project name MVT project, and this is the class name, that is listeners. Save it. Now let's run this. Right click, run as testng suit. Yeah, okay, again the same problem is coming. Any problem I made, guys, intentionally or unknowingly? Don't think so. This should work actually, but it's not working. One minute. So let's see what is going wrong. Here PPAC we are saying. PPAC class 10 is fine. Here we don't have to give anything, I guess. opac.listeners will be enough actually. So where exactly it is going wrong, I just need to figure out. Test written, okay, classes, test. Let's run it again. Right click, run as testng suit. Okay. opac.listeners. So LISTER, you see spelling mistake is there. LIS listeners. LISTENERS. This should be the name. LISTENERS. Yes, yes, correct, guys. So this will be enough, guys. Package name and class name. Package name, class name will be enough. Okay. So let's see this time. Right click, run as testng suit. Hopefully it should work. Yeah. You see, test execution started, already got printed. When the test execution started, you see, this is there in the listeners class. It got invoked already. Right? Then afterwards, test execution successful, test execution ended. This is a successful test, right? This is a successful test because I gave a is equal to 1. A is 1 means successful test. If I give a is equal to, what will happen, guys? If I give a is equal to, here test execution started will come. After that, test execution fail will be printed. Okay, then test execution ended should come, I guess. So let's run this. Right click, run as testng suit. This time I give a is equal to, test execution started. Just see here only, okay? Test execution failed, test execution ended. So appropriate methods are getting invoked or not? Appropriate methods in the listeners class are getting invoked or not, guys? Are you able to get the concept, guys? This listeners class is listening to this automation code, and if test is failing, it's invoking only on successful, on test success. If test is, text is passing, that's then only invoking on test success. If test is failing, when I change a is equal to, test will fail, right? Intentionally test is failing. At that time it is invoking on test failure, and it's printing test execution failed here. You see, on test. Now if I intentionally change this particular thing to a is equal to 3, this time it will skip the test. When test is skipped, listeners will listen to the skipped event, and then it will invoke on test skipped only. It will not invoke these two things. It will invoke test skipped now. Okay. Anyhow, on test start, on test, on finish, everything will be anyhow invoked, because test will start for sure, test will end for sure. So things will be there. but these are like something you can change. You see, this time tests need to be skipped. Execution started, test should be skipped, guys. Let's see what will happen. Yeah, test execution got skipped, test execution ended. Appropriate methods are being invoked by the listeners class by listening to the automation code. Based on the events raised, that particular methods are only invoked. Clear, guys? What's happening? Are you clear now? Why listeners class is required? Are you clear, guys? Did you understand? Great, that's very great. Now one more thing. I told you, right? I will be explaining about iTest result now. Okay, I told you, right? I will be explaining about iTest result. Copy this iTest result. Say put plus iTest result. So here we have result, right? Result. We have to put result here. This result. Okay, just use the result here. Result dot get a name. This result dot get name will also print the test case name that you are actually, this particular listeners class is currently listening to which test case, test method? This one, right? Test 10. This listeners class is now listening to test 10. So it will print test 10. Test execution started for which test case? For test 10. Okay, like that. All these things, wherever you have iTest result, you can put that. I don't know whether context has such kind of thing or not. We'll try for context also for test plus context dot get name. Here also something is there. Let's see what will come for test. I just enhancing the methods, that nothing more than that. Okay, enhancing the existing outputs. Instead of printing the normal plain outputs, I will also say which test got executed and which test has started, which test has failed, which test has skipped, which test has okay success, and all the stuff. This will be more good, right, than the normal printing for test, which test for result dot get name. This will print the test case name for test plus result dot get name. Fine, done. Let's see this time what will happen. So this time again I will change this A to 1. So this test will be successful first, and run this test ng 2 dot xml file. Test execution started for which test? Test 10. You see test 10. It is printing the method now. Method test method now. And test execution successful for which test? Test 10. Test execution ended for which test? Test module 2 is coming. Ended is module name is coming, guys. Okay, so here something, context is something printing a different thing. Okay, context is printing a module name, not you're not getting whatever you want here. So okay, a lot of methods are there here. We don't know which method we have to use and all. That's fine. You can remove for context, only for context you can remove, guys. This is fine. Okay, so this on finish is not having. Or we can do one more thing. We can do one experiment. Okay, sorry. Okay, so here ended, right? Ended is something printing like that. On finish, yeah, on finish only. Yeah, that's correct. On finish, can I put iTest result? I'll just check it. So if I put iTest, we can get the test name. This is an experiment, guys. Let's see whether this is there or not. So let's see what will happen this time. Okay, on test execution started, test method got printed, test method name got printed. On test execution, test 10, but on finish is not working now. So this is not working, guys. So let's move back. So only, let's not print anything. We'll print simply this part will be enough. Okay, we are not able to get the test name for on finish, but remaining things we have iTest result where things are good. Let me run again to see whether everything is working fine or not. Previous results I am closing, guys. Simple. Okay, so what's happening? Yeah, you see, everything got printed now. Event test execution ended also came. Now I'll make this to 2 and see whether what about failure. When failure is happening on test failure, what test should be printed. You see, which test got failed? Test 10. We can, when something fails, for example, you are running some 10 tests, you don't know which test is started, which test failed, right? This is helpful, right? When you are running here, only one test case is there, so you are sure that only this particular test will start, only this particular test will end, only this particular test will pass, fail, skip. But here, if you have 10 tests here in the same class, if you have 10 test methods, okay, you don't know which one has started, which one has failed. So for that, if you print this test 10, that will be good. So we can do the experiment now. Copy this, paste it here. So I'll say test 10 B here, and here I'll give A is equal to 1. Here I'll give A is equal to 2. I'll again copy paste. I'll give C here. Here I'll give A is equal to 3. So three times, three tests will be executed. You see, this time three tests should be executed. Right click run as test ng suit. So first one, test 10, normal test 10 method, which will actually pass, I guess. So actually pass. Will actually pass. So a lot of windows are getting opened, so we are not able to see anything. So you see here, okay, test 10 started, test 10 successful, test 10 test execution started for another test, test 10 B. Test execution failed for another test, that is test 10 B. Then test execution started for another test, test 10 C. Execution got skipped for test 10 C. Then finally, execution has ended. Execution started here, execution ended here. Fine. Like this, guys, like this. Like this, we can get the output. So hope you understood how to use listeners. Is listeners clear for you guys? Is listeners concept clear for you completely? How the listeners can help us? When there are many test cases, things, these are very helpful. You will know which is passing, which is failing, everything. Okay. So they will simply listen to your automation code and print you something in the output or logs or something. You can actually implement logs also. Okay. Logs concept I didn't cover. So instead of this print statement, we'll actually put the logs. That logs concept I'll explain later, guys. Then you will understand. So finally, parallel execution. Finally, parallel execution, guys. So parallel execution is very simple. So we can do whatever we have with whatever we have. We'll open the same testng2.xml file. So here, just simply follow this process. So we have to put this particular things at this test tag level or suit level. If you have multiple, here only one test module is there. Okay, either you put at suit level is same, either you put at test level is same, right? So first of all, let's put this at test level. So we have to say parallel is equal to method. Here thread count is already there, I guess, right? Any test tag is there. Thread count is already there for the test tag, right? If you see here, this test module has thread count as 2. Five. I'll make it 2, guys. Okay. I'll explain why I'm making it as 2. Or you can make it 3 also. That's fine. So here, guys, in our just now we created class 10. How many test methods are there? How many test methods are there, guys? How many test methods are there? 1, 2, 3. Here, we have C also. You can make it A if you want. Test 10 A, test 10 B, test 10 C. Three are there. Can you see, guys? Three test methods are there. One test method, second test method, third test method. Okay, three test methods are there. Now, if I run it normally, they were executing one by one. First, test method A is getting executed, then test method B, then test method C is getting executed, right? But what if I want to execute all these three things at the same time? Parallel execution. You know what is parallel execution? Parallel execution. What do you mean by parallel execution? At the same time, multiple tests needs to be executed. So if parallel execution is not there, what will happen is first test A will be executed. Once test A is completed, once the test A method is executed, execution is completed, then only test B will start. Okay, after test B is completed, then only test C will start. But here, if you implement parallel execution at the same time, test A, test B, test C will be executed. At the same time, if you want to execute these three tests, what you have to do? I'm going to explain. Here you see, three tests got executed, but after test A got executed, then B started. After B got ended, then only C got started. Right? One after another one. But here, I'm going to make a difference. I am going to make it parallel execution. Here, I am going to add thread count is equal to 3. Thread count is equal to 3 means at a single time, how many tests can be executed? If I give thread count is equal to 3 at same time, parallelly, how many tests will be executed, guys? If I give 3. What do you think, guys? 3 tests will be executed. You are right. Okay. So, but still, it is not enough. One more attribute we have to put. That is, we have to say parallel is equal to methods. Then only parallel execution will start. Thread count will give number of tests should be executed at same time. But parallel is equal to methods. Let's see whether I give it a wrong thing. Parallel is equal give the correct thing. Parallel is equal to methods. If you add this attribute with this methods value, so all these tests will be executed parallelly. And how many test methods? 3. If we have 4 test methods here, only 3 will be parallelly run. Fourth one will not be run parallelly. Okay. At same time, only 3 will be chosen. Now let's run this, guys. testng2.xml. Right click, run as testng suit. You see? At same time, how many tests are running? Can you see, guys? Can you see how many tests are running at same time? 3. 3 tests are getting run. Right? Yes. You can see that in this is called parallel execution, guys. Nothing more than that. Okay. You see here from the results also, you see test execution started for B, C, A. 3 tests started. 3 tests started at the same time. And after that, the execution is successful for something, fail for something, skip for something. According to our listeners' configuration, it's happening. That's fine. But here, the focus you have to put here is this part, guys. These two attributes you have to focus. In the test module, you can put thread count is equal to 3. Parallel is equal to methods. What will happen? So all the tests will run at the same time. How many tests? 3. If I change it to 2, only 2 will run. Okay. Only 2 will run. You see now, only 2 will run. So right click run as test ng suit. This time only 2 will run parallelly, not 3. You see only 2 started. You see only at a time only 2. Once one is completed, then only third one will start. This is parallel execution, guys. Okay, this is called as parallel execution. Fine, guys. Hope parallel execution is clear for you guys. So next thing. So fine. So fine. Great. So here one test got passed, failed, skipped as per our configurations. That's fine. That's okay. So this parallel is called methods thread count is put in the test tags. You can also put the same thing in the suit tag also. What will happen in the suit tag when you put in the suit tag? Methods will be running parallelly, but at suit level. You see in this particular suit, only one test module is there. But if you go to testng.xml file, how many are there, guys? How many are there? Many are there, right? So here, if I put the same thing, thread is equal to methods is equal to something, and we'll go to testng dot. Here, multiple test modules are there, so I can put that at the suit level. thread count is equal to 5 or 4. I will give 4. Okay, thread count is equal to 4, parallel is equal to methods, and I will implement listeners also. I'll implement listeners here. Same copy paste, guys. Nothing more than that. Okay, listeners. Just Control Shift F. Organizing will be done. And what else I need to do? Listeners is for listeners only, guys. This is not related to parallel execution. But if you want to get this kind of output, we need listeners. Okay, that's why I'm adding listeners here. And what else is there here? Individual test module count is also mentioned here. You see, 5. We'll actually make it 4. Okay, let's make it unique everywhere. 4. Okay. So, and one more thing we can add, that is, what is that new? We have up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 is there here. 8 is there here. Apart from that, we got two more test methods, right? We'll add something here. So class. Which package, guys? 9 and 10. We need 9 and 10. 9 is from KPack. Okay, this is KPack. And other one is 10. 10, class 10 is from PPack. PPack. Class 10, I will say. That's it. Let's run this testng.xml file now and see what's happening. Parallelly, how many test cases should run? It's root level I gave. Thread count is equal to 4. Parallel is equal to methods. So right click run as testng root. Okay. Some problems are coming. That's okay. But let's see how many classes you see. You see here, a lot of things are happening. Failed test one. You see test execution started. Failed. A lot of things are happening parallelly, guys. Okay. Forget about the errors. But you can see the difference, right? How the things are executing parallelly, right? How the things are, at suit level we have given. Suit level means it applies to all the test modules. Just focus. Just need to focus. Let's not troubleshoot anything here. It will take a lot of time. Okay. So for now, just think that at suit level, all these things will be executed. So test module 1 will be executed. Test module 2 will be executed, and all the methods of the test modules will be executed parallelly. Okay, at suit level, if you give all the classes of this test module will be executed parallelly. So at a time, only 4 like that. Okay, until all the test methods are completed, everything will be executed. Fine, guys. That is suit level. So everything has run. Everything has run almost. So we got some errors. We can resolve that. So test 1A, test 1B, something. Some problems are coming. That's okay. We can fix it out at later point of time. Execution failed, started, Flipkart. You see, everything is running parallelly, guys. 4 methods are running parallelly. 4 methods are running parallelly. You can increase the count also. If you want, you can increase this parallel count to 10 also. At a single time, everything will start. At a single time, how many test methods are in this classes? 10 classes are there, but inside that, many test methods are there, right? Many test methods are there. So count may be very, very huge. That's fine. So parallel execution is possible with the help of testng. If someone asks you a question, parallel execution in automation is possible with help of what? You have to say testng is the answer, guys. Okay, parallel execution at same time, if you want to run multiple tests, you have to use what, guys? You have to use testng. So is parallel execution clear for you, guys? Is parallel execution clear for you? Guys, is parallel execution clear for you? So these are advanced concepts of testng, guys. Okay, all these are the advanced concepts of testng. So you have to practice very well, guys. We have one more thing, that is Selenium grid, but the time is already up, guys. I cannot take up this concept. Fine. So we are left out with this concept, but fine. So we are done with the part 3 of testng, guys. We are done with the part 3 of testng. So I'll be covering up these things in the next session. Okay, I'll be covering up these concepts in the next session. Fine, guys. Okay, so guys, if you have any questions, you can type here, or if you are clear, you just type yes and then that's for that today. Okay.